Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I'm Samir Mehta, your moderator. This is case number 108. First of all, an announcement that several of you have already asked me about the live cases that were shown at the CCC meeting which concluded last week. They will be available within 2 weeks. Several other questions about the different types of cases and all that, of course, I'll be discussing both with Dr. Sharma and Dr. Kinney so that you can get a better idea and the best viewing experience of these cases which were just performed. This morning, we have a truly complex case, a CTO in a patient who's had a previous bypass surgery, but let me take you to the cardiac catheterization laboratory so that we can get more details. Anu, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Samin, yeah. Congratulations, first of all, for this was the 2021st year?
Yeah, 21st year and fantastic. Just it was a very well attended and a lot of cases. We did 13 actually, didn't do the 14, the septal ablation, but all 13 cases were done very well. And with the PTA, with the TMVR being the height, really the great case.
Last year you had asked me what I felt was the best case and there were many choices. This time there was no doubt.
Absolutely.
And is it correct that hopefully we should have these online in about 2 weeks' time?
Oh, absolutely, yes, in 2 weeks. In the volume. Yeah, absolutely.
Anu, take us through what do you have in store for us today. It's a CTO in a patient with a previous bypass surgery.
Yeah, so patient previous bypass, as we announced on our the e-blast. Let's go back to the slide with this, our supporters. I think we need to update now and our disclosure. So this is a 72-year-old patient who is a vasculopath, has peripheral disease as well as coronary, had multiple PCIs, and then went for bypass surgery and had a four-vessel bypass. And then presented a few months ago with class 3 angina and dyspnea and claudication. So leg had also femoral artery stenosis, which was stented.
And multiple PTAs.
PTAs. And then, more importantly, he also had a significant ischemia, which led to cath. And we'll go through the catheterization. The LIMA is open. All the grafts are closed. And the native circ and Ramus were opened with the PTC and stent. And today, the bare metal stent, which was before done many years ago, we don't know exact timing, we don't even know whether it's a bare metal or DES, had ISR totally occluded, for which vein graft to RCA was placed, and that has been totally occluded, and that's what the intervention today will be. So this is the circumflex, show the circumflex actually. They did the
very aggressive graft disease.
Yes. Yeah. So the circumflex, This is the...
You're seeing the angiogram?
Yeah. Lima looks
okay, yeah,
good.
The LIMA to LAD
is good.
Looks good. And then this is the LVGram, which is also okay. And here we have...
The circ and ramus, which have been opened by PTC and stent, and looks very good. Next. And then you see the collateral to the right coronary artery below. Looks like a multiple stents in the right. Yeah. Next.
No, but also the LAD. And
yeah, but LAD has a LIMA, so that's okay.
No, what I meant is the
collaterals. Yeah, a lot of ISR, yeah, exactly.
Collaterals from the
LAD. In case we need to go to retrograde, yes.
Collaterals from the LAD to RCA. And essentially, you see it's a dominant RCA with the total occlusion right where that stent starts.
See that?
Okay, let me show you the next one.
We don't know when the right stents were placed.
Yeah, it was before the bypass.
Right.
All these stents were before the bypass. After the bypass in 2012, it's the first episode of recurrence of the chest pain and angiogram to the patient. Before that, patient has 8 angiogram and stents. So therefore, I would say, and he has been having these procedures done since 1996. So in the last 20 years, sometime it was done, and it did not have a details because were not done at Mount Sinai Hospital, were done in Brooklyn, and so.
So possibility of a bare metal stent there.
We can't hear him. Increase
the volume. Yeah, it is very likely. So with that note, let's go back to our presentation very quickly. That patient also had other factors and on good medical therapy, including the diabetics and so, and the patient now here for PCI of the complex proximal RCA CTO ISR via antegrade or retrograde approach if failed, followed by rotational or laser atherectomy and DES implantation. So this is what we need to see, because I think this is a good case for the laser, because total occlusion, although there are multiple stents here, we may end up in doing a rotational atherectomy also. And then the in terms of OCT criteria, this is a patient who had the LIMA to LAD patent without stenosis.
Daisy.
And this will be appropriate because of the therapy. So with that note, we are ready here. Anu, tell us where you're planning it.
Yeah, so yeah. You can see the dual injection. The question would be the same, that we have side holes of the AL point. Yeah, okay. AL 0.75 is a guide for the right coronary artery.
Anu,
then we have the dual injection on the left system.
Osteal disease also, you think?
Yeah.
I don't know osteal disease.
Osteal seems to be maybe
it's
some.
Just
say maybe some.
Mild, diffuse disease.
But why you're not hearing him well? Why Dr. Mehta has either increased the volume here? Yeah, okay.
Sameen, is that better?
Yeah, now it is better, yes, okay. Absolutely, yeah.
So if you can see, the total occlusion starts where the stent has been placed and looks like the mid portion of the RCA, the ISR, maybe the distal RCA part of the stent is ISR but not totally occluded. The question here always comes the same, that since you have the stent in the ISR, that do you need dual injection or you don't have to have a dual injection? Or you should still have dual injection because your exit point, you have to be clear that you are in the vessel, not subintimal when you are at the distal part of the vessel.
Yep.
That is why, if you see here, if you this one. You see the distal vessel? The PDA looks very well.
It looks a very large right coronary artery.
Yes.
And it started with the fielder. You saw that little glimpse that it started going, and we are ready to start now. And question is the escalation strategy. Once the fielder doesn't go, then we go with the
Gaia.
Gaia.
That's,
yep.
That's one of the lessons from the meeting.
Yes.
So this is the fielder?
This is a fielder, yeah.
So Anu, what chance do you think you should be able to cross this antegrade? Pretty good?
Yeah. Since it's an in-stent restenosis, I can also tell you, now this is a very old stent. You have to be ready with the stiffer wires like a starter here, yeah. Many times we have seen that these ISRs, old ISRs are very resistant. And you need very the real stiff wires to get through.
Well, that is fantastic progress you're making so far.
Let me see if we can go a little area, floor.
Right.
No, the floor without overlap. Yeah, good. This is the good one. Yeah.
Let me get the.
I don't think there is any question that this is all in the true lumen. It's not through any struts.
What happened?
What? Same the fine cross and always the same. I mean, we are used to fine cross, but you can always have any kind of a transit catheter if you want to go with the.
It is both your skills as well as a little good luck, but the case suddenly became a whole lot easier.
This now, can we see where it's going? Why you are in this?
Job.
Okay,
look,
you want to.
Sometimes these straightforward decisions, we don't pay attention to that, but how they contribute, I think the guiding catheter was exactly right.
Ready?
It's AL 0.75, right?
Yeah, the support catheter just perfect. And
good. Yeah, it's in the distal vessel.
Yeah.
But looks like there is a ISR, even distal is CTO.
Yeah, yeah.
But happens to be soft.
So Sameen, in the almost in my previous life, as I go beyond the years of STEMI interventions, I used to have tremendous experience and interest in laser angioplasty.
What do you want to do?
Which,
leave
of course, over
there?
The last several years, it has
or
become
change it to
more
run through
of a peripheral device
so you know it is better.
Dysfunctional leads, pacemaker leads.
Yes.
Run through, run through. Yep. And then you use the dark is better with run through.
Yep, that is true. So basically, some isolated cases, we are using laser, and this is ideal case for the laser would be. Again, there is no randomized trial at present to answer the question in this day and age that
but
whether laser, we know that even the rotation atherectomy trials, artist, roster, artist was negative, roster was plus minus, that even rotation atherectomy, we use it, but clearly is not supported by any randomized data.
Absolutely. Yeah. But technically, just from the usage point of view, the straight segment within the stent, these used to be some of the best cases to teach the laser. You have a straight shot, although I think one would use a 0.9, but these are the kind of cases you may even go with a 1.4, but I think 0.9.
0.9, because 1.4 require a bigger guide catheter and so. And the other question is, we can go with a different energy.
Right.
And the other question is, should it be with the saline or the dye? So that's another concept.
Well, saline is always the right way to do it, but...
But some cases of unexpanded stent,
right,
that can be done, because you want to create an explosion there, not vaporization. So that should be done later with the dye. So that question came up when we did a case last week.
You did a wonderful case there.
That was a fantastic case. Good. Okay, ready with the laser?
Yes.
All right. So we are starting with the 40-40?
40-40.
Yeah. So that's a start, 40-40 energy and fluence.
So the real question here, Sameen, is going to be, maybe you and Annu could remark on that, exactly at which point do you think you'll start lasing? Right at the beginning of the stent? Or
yes,
where you
right at the beginning of the stent and keep going keep
throughout
going down
the length of the stent.
Yes. Yeah.
And if any segment doesn't go, then you do rota. We actually have few cases where laser did not go, and we end up in doing the rotation atherectomy.
No,
although we use laser only cases where we cannot do the rotation atherectomy.
No, not because not because we cannot do it, since we could not change it to
change
rota
it to
wire.
Rota wire.
Once
absolutely
you have crossed, yep, the same yep thing with the CTO. You cross with the CTO wire.
Yeah.
Now you so cannot get. You know. Okay. Ready?
Sailing.
Yes. Start sailing. Yes. 40-40. Slow, okay, just make sure you're good. I'm going to go back
so
again.
The traditional thinking used to be you advance at about a millimeter per second.
Per second, yeah.
Go.
And then start from that area. This one you don't have to pull back like rota.
Well, no, I know. Yeah. I just wanted to make sure because it
yeah
went but forward.
Manu, if you withdraw the wire a little bit, you'll be...
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, good. Okay.
Keep going.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think this will debulk like a rota. Go.
Making good progress.
Okay.
Seem to be through the whole length of the stent.
It's not coming.
Good,
you know.
Good.
Okay, go. I think you have to do 1 fiber. Not do anything. No?
We'll see.
Yeah.
Get a rotor wire also in case we need to go with the bigger bar.
1 fire, 1.75. Go.
And extra support.
Extra support. Go.
Okay, go. Did we see,
eh? Yeah, I think also you need to take a look at.
Go.
But still, cath the wire went all the way. I mean, the laser catheter went all the way.
Okay. Yeah, but that's where I think there's this much greater calcification in that segment.
Yeah. Here you want to make 60-60?
Okay. Yeah, go.
Yeah.
Okay, go. Okay.
Okay, do the last one now.
Go. I think did we do the exit?
Yeah.
That's the key. No, yeah. No, I don't think we did.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, one more.
That definitely advanced there. No, maybe the guide came back.
Yeah. No, that's because you're hitting resistance.
Right, right.
And give the retrograde out now. Okay.
Okay, now.
One more. I think we are okay.
No, I haven't hit the native SL.
Okay.
Okay, go.
Do one more. No. Yeah, we are in the native.
No, no. It's still in the stent.
Do you do some antegrade injection? No.
See that? We're still within the stent.
Okay.
Yeah,
they must have used different stents because their visibility is so completely different.
Yep.
Okay, go. You want to go 80-80?
Right. Good. Don't give a little end. No, yeah, that's fine.
Cannot.
We don't have any. Yeah, good. 80-80.
You want to
ready?
Go? Retrograde and
that's enough.
Okay, go 80-80.
80-80, ready.
Go.
Mm-hmm. I think the laser has done its
you dead now.
Yeah,
dead.
You know, when you reach these levels, and yeah, although good. We are in the confines of the stent, it's a little safer, but
yeah,
it's clearly getting stuck.
Yeah. Yeah. I think not reaching.
Yeah.
Question is, do we balloon or go with 1.25 bar?
Well, first of all, give some nitro. Let's take a look and then decide. But you know, it did go through almost 80 millimeters of a segment. Sameen, I think there is a very intriguing use of laser for which people should consider it. These are acute MI cases presenting late with more organized thrombus.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I think in parts of the world, in fact, in most parts of the world where patients present late, this is an attractive possibility, but just the capital cost of the laser.
No, wouldn't it cause embolization?
No. It does, but for the organized, well, good. It's done a good job
good.
When you have a...
Good.
No, but distally.
Distally, it has not.
You get a 2.5 balloon. No, it's okay.
So, Anu, you're right about it, but for the dense, organized cases where all you need to do is make a single pass, it's intriguing. I've just done a single case, so I have no basis, but from the
literature. There are a lot of work on the acute MI cases.
On
the same.
On topaz.
On topaz and so, and the vein graft as well as acute MIs actually cause less embolization.
Right.
And the whole idea is that evaporation of the thrombus.
And a single pass. Single pass. With the most of the time 1.4 is the one which should work fine.
Yeah.
So this is a balloon, Anu?
Yeah.
Yes.
2.5. Guide is the other side.
Nothing guide.
Just connect it. Take it out, just connect directly.
No, it will come out.
So clearly it did make a nice channel, otherwise the balloon would not have gone through.
Blood pressure is low. You give too much nitro.
No, go on again. What I'm saying is just connect this to the femoral directly. It keep attaching to the wall.
Good, go. And you give too much nitro, looks like.
Give fluoro.
Yes, yes.
The LV was normal.
Yeah, but probably was. What are the EDP?
ST elevation.
Yeah, that's the reason. Okay, don't get too crazy now.
Yep.
Okay, ten. Down.
It's a very large vessel.
Do you have to stent all this now?
Yeah, all the way. No,
IVUS. Let's IVUS it and then make
a After this, we'll do the IVUS.
Anu, the CTO case you had done fairly similar, where Sunil
RCA.
Rao, I remember, made the suggestion of using IVUS.
No, this is a different reason for IVUS.
Yeah, here you also want to ISR. See the explore the stent.
How many layers?
Right.
This is 2.520 NC. If you can, with a microscope, with binocular, you know, this is so
crazy. Horrible. They cannot see it.
So, I mean, that was the best practical suggestion at the meeting. Go. That, you know, these should be big. I have no idea why.
Write it on the shaft. There is a big shaft there. I mean, what's wrong in that?
Absolutely.
Now, here we may need a cutting balloon, no? Wolverine.
Yeah.
This part. This is a 2.5, right?
Yeah, let do the IOS decide. Yeah. 3 or 3.5 will decide.
Go up here.
Little more back. So one more only.
Okay, that's good. The question, you want to go up to the native vessel and stand the native vessel also?
We'll see. Let's do opening and now.
Okay,
we'll do.
IOS.
No, picture and then IOS. We need a little verapamil. You start seeing some slow flow, some ST elevation, thinking it will be embolization or collateral shut off.
Could be thrombus also there, you know.
Right.
Chronic total occlusion. Ready?
Bivalirudin for this patient?
Yes. I think we are the only
large institution
that uses bivalirudin for CTO.
Yeah.
Ready?
Yeah.
Go.
Looking good.
We dissected the distal vessel.
Yep. Okay. Now, what's the plan now? Let's talk about it.
IVUS and then make a decision. No?
Okay.
How many layers of stent?
Good.
Get us a 2.538.
To me, mid segment of the RCA looks like at least two layers, if not more.
Mm. What do you want to do there? If it's already two layers.
No, I think they're bare metal. Right now our goal is we have to re-endothelize this vessel with the metal.
DES.
With the metal, yes. The DES metal. That's it.
Saveen, you want to start your the two topics you're
talking
about?
Yeah, while they're doing the IVUS, absolutely. So let's go to our two topics.
Now then we will start stenting, okay, when you're talking.
Okay, but you want to do IVUS first then?
We'll IVUS.
Okay, then let's do the IVUS first.
And then we can decide what and we just stent it.
Then stent, there's no other.
Anu, there's a question which has come for you. Would you have considered OCT here also?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, we were discussing OCT. Yeah. Once you have a lumen like this with a good distal flow, could have done OCT. See the flow in the distal vessel?
Yeah.
Even though it's not completely normal.
Right.
So, I think OCT would not be a good idea.
But we did talk about that. Should we do
should IVUS? We have done OCT or IVUS?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. We're ready to start.
Then you have to do two runs
to
get the 75 millimeter into two.
Go.
Okay. This is the native, the distal native.
Yeah. We see it now.
Yeah.
Good. I thought there would be more calcification there. There you start seeing it.
All plaque.
All plaque. And we start seeing the stent starts.
Wow. Now.
There you go. That's
already two layers there.
Yeah. Two layers there.
About a
what
trio?
Are we going to do? We can't put another
one,
layer.
1, 2, 3. Yeah, no, this one we had to put a 3.
So we take a 2.5.
Yeah.
Right?
That is okay. 2.5 long.
What's
on the left side, you put Alpine. You put the Alpine, so Alpine again.
I mean the
right. Xience Sierra. And again, one layer here.
No, it's all two layers.
See?
All two layers.
This is, you're still in the distal segment.
Yeah. No, we are now, you see that in the acute A. So
now two layers again.
Two layers, all two layers.
Yep. This could be even 3. Right now is that area.
This particular segment could do with more ablation, no? If you realize
that.
All the lumen has started opening up there.
Yeah, stent itself is... we could go, I think what we'll do is we'll do a 3-0 Wolverine.
Right.
Then we will do a 3-0 high pressure balloon.
No, but
then
why don't
we'll
put a stent the distal first?
Okay.
So it has a nice lumen because there will be a lot of
embolization. This is the proximal now.
Yeah.
Okay, get, give the, cross-sectional area please, there.
Oh, tight. Yeah.
Bookmark.
Okay, good. Take it out now.
You did not. I think you need to come up to the ostium.
Okay, yeah. All right. Keep it there in case we need later. Good. So let's put a short, distal 2.533.
What 33? 38.
38, okay.
It would be only 38.
Yeah.
Question
all right.
is how many 38?
Yeah, 3. Okay, give us a 2.538.
Sierra, quickly.
And then bring a 3 and 3.5, but bring one at a time, quick. Good. So plan will be standing.
No.
Yeah.
Proximal.
Okay.
Now yeah, there. Yeah. Trace assist.
Yeah.
Come inside a little bit.
Yeah, it will be less than 4. So we have to come almost up to the ostium here.
Yeah. This is it.
Maybe leave the ostium, but just proximally. Okay. We can go with our presentation now.
So we'll just keep stenting, okay?
Possibly 4 stents.
Yeah.
Could be 4. And I think this deserves it. The guy, but everything has been done for this patient.
Right. Also, patient such a large vessel, I think.
Have they put a patient
through this? Will probably become his most important vessel.
Okay, nice. Good. Huh? Why?
Okay. Don't worry. Yeah.
So therefore, we'll talk about 2 things. One is the update in management of in-stent restenosis, ISR, and the current recommendation for antiplatelet therapy switch. So ISR, as we know, is a little different for BMS versus DES, and there are various factors. Biological, mechanical, technical, which I wrote down here. It is a nice review article by Josh Dangus and the team. Key is, it's all intimal hyperplasia. But some of the ISR occur because of underexpansion, stent fracture, incomplete coverage, and the gap. So these are the various factors we need to think about, and of course imaging will help in these cases. Second, BMS versus DES, there is a pathological difference in terms of the histopathology of the ISR. The particularly bare metal stent has more smooth muscle cell rich, and less inflammation, less calcium, and less neoatherosclerosis, while in the DES you have more neoatherosclerosis and it's a proteoglycan and usually acellular. Therefore, data have shown when you do a PCI of the DES, many times you see embolization, and that's material, that cheesy material which goes downstream and plugs up the microvasculature. And these are the individual differences between 2 stent types. And then the whole treatment of the DES and their prediction that what is going to happen subsequently is dependent on pattern of restenosis, which was actually initially described in 1999 in Circulation by Roxana Maran. ISR of the focal, type 2 diffuse, 3 diffuse proliferative, and 4 total occlusion. And you can see big gradient that with the increasing TVR, when you go to a total occlusion, almost 83% in the BMS. Now, what about the DES era? It's about the similar mechanism. As you can see here, focal versus non-focal, that clearly the non-focal has a higher the TVR compared to the focal. Now then, the other point which we had learned, that when you have the restenosis, in the DES, in the BMS used to be diffuse, in the DES is usually focal, so that's a great. Second, if you compare BMS versus DES with all the techniques, whether it's a balloon angioplasty, drug-coated balloon, or the another DES, BMS does better than the DES ISR. So, and then of course histopathology I already said. So key is the DES ISR is a problem and is associated with higher subsequent event rate, and now as I said that maybe a slightly higher complication rate also. So now more important, like which fits into this patient, that is the CTO ISR, which exactly this patient was. So what are the data basically? It showed that de novo CTO versus ISR CTO has different unique pathological mechanism, and clearly could be microchannel, more thrombus, so and so forth. And in-stent CTO is behave badly, lower procedural success and higher MACE rate compared to the de novo CTO. So the ISR CTO is bad compared to de novo CTO. So now how do we deal with that? One, you can always try medical therapy, some cases, and of course some go for bypass, but majority of them go for intervention with a PTCA, coated cutting balloon, or scoring balloon, drug eluting balloon, or drug coated balloon, then laser, ELCA, which we did today, rotablation we do. Usually we do rotablation if there are multiple branches or unexpanded stent, restenting, or brachytherapy. So one of the exciting area has been IVBT, there were trials originally done comparing IVBT with the re-DES, and all of them DES1. So we don't use, we stopped using the IVBT at that time. But of course, now it has resurrected, because many times patients, even with the DES, comes back. And similar data, we actually, our paper is with the fourth revision, which we have given, submitted to one of the journal of the IVBT data for DES ISR at Mount Sinai Hospital. Now then there was a rescue registry that you have DES restenosis, should you put another DES or IVBT? Seems to be IVBT do a little better than re-DES. Then multiple data since then have come that if you have DES ISR, do you do a balloon or you do another stent? So there are some data to say maybe putting another sandwich stent may be more complicated, having a higher event rate, maybe higher thrombosis than MI, and if it's a good enough balloon angioplasty does the job, and particularly if it is a focal ISR. So then we have multiple randomized trials in this field, and I'm going to show those trials basically one by one. First one was the ISR desire. That was the patients who have a BMS restenosis. They randomized to either SCS or paclitaxel eluting stent, and you saw the outcomes were identical with the both of the strategy. Then the question always came, you have a DES with the Xience restenosis, should you put the heterolomus or paclitaxel stent as a another DES, which is called hetero versus homo DES, and it turns out to be that no matter what type of re-DES you use, it does not change the overall outcome as shown by multiple trials, and this I have given one example here. So then came the drug-coated balloon or drug-eluting balloon, which really particularly using paclitaxel in various randomized trial of the conventional PTCA or using the cutting balloon or using the re-BMS and DES, all combined analysis showed the cutting balloon to be superior to your conventional strategy. But here, in the early time, it was compared against the first generation DES, so was no good. So cutting balloon originally seems to be better than even DES, but then since then, many trials were done comparing the paclitaxel eluting balloon compare against paclitaxel eluting stent or balloon angioplasty. That was the ISR desire 3. So this is basically just showing that once you compare the drug-coated balloon against first generation drug-coated stent, outcomes were identical or maybe even a little better in the area of the drug-coated balloon at a 1 year and 3 year outcome of the ISR desire 3. So and question always was that once you do the drug-coated balloon, is there a catch-up phenomena after 1 year? And answer to landmark analysis of this ISR desire 3 shows that no, there's no catch-up phenomena. Then the other trials done now with the latest our everolimus eluting stent compared against the drug-coated balloon, and you can see a RIPS 4 was for the DES ISR of 300 patients, and you can see now all of a sudden the everolimus eluting stent is better, performing better than drug eluting balloon of the paclitaxel in the RIPS 4 trial, and same RIPS 5 for the bare metal ISR, again EES is better than drug coated balloon. So now you say all of a sudden what we were saying, the drug coated balloon is better, the EES has an equal rather slightly better in terms of the minimum lumen area, MLD at follow-up, as well as the lower mace and restenosis. The latest data, now we understand that paclitaxel eluting balloon technique is a little different. You had to leave it for 60 seconds. You had to score the lesion maybe beforehand, and that was the DARE trial in the latest data which was presented last year, and basically showed that with the drug eluting balloon versus everolimus eluting stent, now similar MLD and similar outcome. So it seems to be that both may be equal. As you know, European guideline has made drug-coated balloon or drug-eluting balloon of paclitaxel as a class 1 indication for treatment of ISR. Then the other question was, what if you, because one of the issue with the drug-coated balloon is the drug doesn't stay there. What if you use a scoring balloon? And that basically was the ISR desire 4 trial using a scoring balloon, that you have a lower better MLD, lower late loss, and lower restenosis, and little better outcome scory balloon versus control. I mean, that is regular balloon angioplasty. So it makes sense, once you're using drug-coated balloon, use a scoring balloon, whether angiosculpt although was used in this study, but you can use the cutting balloon also, just like we are using here. But we don't have the drug-coated balloon available in United States. Now, there always has been issue in terms of anti-proliferative property, as we know, of the paclitaxel. So what about sirolimus eluting balloon? So there is one data in a small study, and now we have separate trial of 1 year clinical outcome. It's not a randomized trial, but overall showing the similar data. I don't think it's a better than what we have for the paclitaxel eluting drug-coated balloon, but seems to be similar, but we still need to wait for the randomized trial data. Now, of the various strategies for ISR, there is a meta-analysis in the Lancet, and it basically showed that EES is maybe superior to any other strategy for DES ISR, as shown by their meta-analysis. Now, this basically leads to that what you do, drug-coated balloon, I think it's preferred in a smaller vessel, in the bifurcation, in restenotic lesion with multiple stents, while re-DES, the data are with the EES, which is preferred in the large vessel, and particularly if there is a fracture or at the edges of the stent and so on. So then the laser, which we talked about it, I think it's a good technique in these cases, and working by photoablation, evaporation, and so, really we have the good expansion. We don't have a new trials in the DES era. There are some trials, registry more in the early, late 90s, using laser in the BMS ISR. So I just put it together here, our algorithm, basically focal versus diffuse. I think the focal does okay with the balloon angioplasty, and then you do re-DES, it comes back. And proliferative is basically that you have low threshold for re-stenting and use a brachytherapy once those comes back after two. And of course, many of these patients can go for bypass surgery. And so knowing I have not put a drug-coated balloon in our this algorithm because not available in United States. So quickly, just to current recommendation for antiplatelet therapy switch, this is a very nice article. This is an international expert consensus on switching platelet P2Y12 receptor therapy. I want everybody to look into it because this is a very important subject. Patients, sometimes you have to escalate and de-escalate. Patients are on weaker antiplatelet or stronger antiplatelet, having bleeding. Now you want to go to a second lower one, clopidogrel, but at the same time you worry about stent thrombosis and so on and so forth. So this, based on their pharmacological property of four agents, clopidogrel, prasugrel, ticagrelor, and cangrelor, has gone a very nice overall review in this subject with their recovery, offset and onset action that takes about 3 to 4 days for ticagrelor and clopidogrel, and 7 days for prasugrel. So when you are trying to use these drugs, and always question have been the drug-drug interaction, that can, the by giving a, one, if there's one antiplatelet therapy in the body, you give second one, would you decrease or increase the effect, antiplatelet effect of that agent? And all the studies have shown that the prasugrel or ticagrelor are effective, much more effective, swipe in the prasugrel and respond in the ticagrelor is compared to clopidogrel. Then it led to many studies called swap group of studies, which try to see if you switch from one to second, what is your platelet inhibition. These are all platelet inhibition trial, showed prasugrel better than clopidogrel. Swap 2, again, what dose you should use, and then swap 3 by using ticagrelor, and latest being swap 4, which is switching from ticagrelor to clopidogrel. It's showing that you need to give a bolus. Even then, you will not, platelet inhibition will not be as good as what would have been on ticagrelor. So this actually is a very nice diagram, and I want everybody to memorize or put into their working. That is, the when you switch these agents, it depends you are doing it in early phase, means less than 30 days, or you're doing it after 30 days. And you can see here, when you are doing clopidogrel versus prasugrel, even early days, you have to give a bolus. But once you go to from clopidogrel to ticagrelor or prasugrel, there, again, you have to give a bolus, whether it's a short term, early phase, or late phase, because you work on a different pathway. And then after the 1 month, you can have just a maintenance dose without giving a loading dose. And then the having the particularly our intravenous inhibitor of cangrelor, that how to bridge And it seems to be that you try to, as soon as you stop the infusion of the IV cangrelor, that you should be starting the agent at that time, although ticagrelor can be given even a little before. But key is the transition of IV to oral PTY12 should happen immediately after stopping the infusion. And we know it's a rapid acting, 5 to 6 minutes IV cangrelor, effect is gone within 1 hour. Therefore, you had to give a loading dose of the antiplatelet therapy. And this is what I learned, actually. We used to recommend only just the maintenance dose, but no. True is that once you are switching from IV cangrelor to oral PTY12, you have to give a loading dose of a respective loading dose of 600 milligram for clopidogrel, 60 milligram for prasugrel, 180 milligram for ticagrelor. So just to sum up very quickly, so this field is still evolving, because we all know there is very little stent thrombosis or ischemic event, but after 1 month you worry about the bleeding. So there was one trial called TOPIC where after 1 month patients were either continue on the new PTY12 or they switched to clopidogrel, and found that by switch DAP had a lower event rate, largely because of lower bleeding. No difference in ischemic event, but lower bleeding. So then there is another trial called Tropical ACS, which was a randomized open label trial that basically looking at the patients with acute coronary syndrome, where you started the prasugrel at 14 days, in half of the patient you continued, and other half, you 7 days prasugrel, then you stopped it, then you started 7 days of clopidogrel, at 14 days did a platelet reactive unit. And if the platelet reactive unit showed high reactivity in 40% of cases, you continue prasugrel again with a 10 milligram dose. But if there was no increase in platelet reactivity, means PRU was less than 230, then you continue on the clopidogrel. Very interesting tropical ACS trial presented in ACS in Lancet, and showed that this switch strategy, having just the prasugrel for 1 week in acute coronary syndrome, actually does better compared to your continuation, largely because no difference in ischemic, but definitely lower bleeding endpoint. So this is where we are in this field, and we'll now ready for Dr. Keeney to see what they have done.
We placed two stents, if you see here. So the first stent, this is the second stent. Before doing the stent, if you can see what we did was, this was the first stent, right, 2538, looked okay. But after that, we did PTCA of the, took a Wolverine.
Right. That's
325 Wolverine, you saw.
And took it till the distal.
All the way. But see, this is where the issue is. This part, I think I am not happy with the way it did not completely expand to what we want, which is, you saw with the IVUS, right? We have a couple of two layers of stent and intimal hyperplasia, which is, chronic. And I think this is the best we can get. Yeah. So now the last stent will be a 3538.
Yeah, exactly.
Good. Right?
Go for
it. Okay, that's it. Okay, open.
Sameen, excellent review of a very, very important topic, particularly the switch has so many implications. I think people struggle with it, and your recommendation to follow that article, I think, is right on.
And I can tell you the graph which they make, it actually says both ways. To go one versus other, and I want everybody to memorize in our interventional manual of the our interventional. We are going to use this, and I can tell you the eye opener in the sense that, can we just show that graph 1 second slide? The key is, because this is a very important one. Contrary to the recommendation, I always used to believe that you don't need to give a loading dose,
right.
But with the pharmacodynamics, whatever the data available at this time, you have to go, because this is the international consensus. Both European and American have agreed it, published in Circulation. So if anything happened to the patient, we'll be responsible. So clearly, after 1 month, I think not an issue, but less than 1 month, you have to do with a loading dose. And that is there very clear in this article. Okay, now we get ready here.
So the last, we may need one more, I guess. One more stent, no?
None. Yeah, okay, go on one floor again, please.
Hold on, let me see. Yeah. Placement.
Move back a little
so
bit.
So, this is where we best,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, third will be okay, yeah. This is the 3.538.
Which make is it, and why did you decide that?
I think the left side patient's PCI were all done with this stent.
So, Sameen, just based on the data you have demonstrated, if we had the drug eluting balloon, that should have been the top choice?
Yeah, exactly. Good, right? Yep. Good.
Okay, go up. Yeah. Now, the only one thing is, if you are coming up to the ostium, this is not the best guide.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You see that?
Right.
And we are leaving
2 millimeters off, so we are okay. So this is a 3-5. So essentially, we're trying to say that once we crossed, you have to do some kind of atherectomy, which is a rota or laser. Then we did atherotomy. Okay. Then you got to do high pressure balloons. Yeah. Stent, and now post it. Now we have 3-5, 30 millimeter balloon ready to post.
That one. Take this out there.
Yeah. You have to be careful now. Just
so again, even with this stent expansion, there was that area in the proximal part of the first stent which was not fully.
I think now with the high pressure balloon, it will open up.
Should be okay. Yeah.
Yeah. That's the only thing that, remember when you guys said don't go back with the laser, that's where I wanted to go back to see
more ablation.
Ablation.
Anu, in the meantime, congratulations. You've had another very important award, the one given by the American Heart Association, the Heart of Gold Awards.
Yeah, yes. Thank you.
This is exceptional and adds to your accolades which you have received globally. Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
And there is also, today is a big live case day for you, no? Many
yes.
cases you are doing for C3.
Yeah, yes. We are doing one at 11 o'clock and then 3 o'clock will be all women's case again.
Yes, that has become the new expertise at your institution, starting from, I think, CRT was the first one where you did that.
Yes.
Yeah. And I told the way, I said, let's do this one, and he was very happy.
Right.
So to made this, and now actually all the male are complaining that there should be all male session.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a minority. You know that actually the joke was the internet joke last year, 2 years ago, for Olympics, because India participated and they won, the only the women won the medals, no man. So
right.
Somebody was asking, will there be a man Olympics?
Yes.
Separate.
But Anu, this is a very prestigious award and just fantastic. Sameen, what are the cases you are showing today at C3?
Yeah, they want a bifurcation case. Bifurcation, because one is with the European Bifurcation Club.
Go.
So they wanted a bifurcation case shown, and not necessarily with the impella, although I have this very complex case, 3-vessel disease. Patient has refused.
Okay,
CABG, diabetic, young guy, about 56, and has all vessels closed except the OM1. So that patient we try to do and multiple bifurcation, CERC bifurcation, RCA bifurcation, and so.
Now also, this is June, end of all our fellows graduating. So we will bring all the fellows here, who many of them have, most of them have rotated and done all the live cases with us. Who else is there?
Sameen, there is a question from our good friend Dr. Botello from Uberlândia, Brazil.
Go up here, assess.
Can you use the laser with the guideliner?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
100%.
That.
Compared to rota, where we are, you know, questionable.
And
you need a 7 French
and
you have to be very careful. Laser, yes, 100%.
Excellent.
It will go in. 6 French laser will take the 0.09. Yes.
Yeah, for 1.4, you need a 7 French, yes. But 6 French will go through it.
And as you see, 0.9 is good enough for coronaries.
Sameen, another follow-up question which has come. What is the status of the DEB in the US at the moment?
Yeah, actually, you know what? That's very interesting.
Ready?
That
ready?
They have not
take
started any trial. And in a large vessel, I used the peripheral balloon, DEB balloon, but definitely there is no.
Good. Everything looks excellent.
Fantastic.
Here.
Take it out,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. No, take one picture better. Yeah.
No, but this is
good. Yeah. No, so that, and I think the companies are not ready to come because of the plus minus data of various trials. Remember, it came out that maybe re-DES is better than drug-coated balloon, but there's still a room for all that. Good. Yeah, go. You get everybody there.
Little
all right.
You're the only me clapping.
Yeah.
Now we join you in the congratulations, Anu. Great case. Such a large vessel. Excellent teaching tips for the laser as well as with the atherectomy. And Sameen, just a superb description of all the relevant trials, and particularly I think the relevance of the switch trial.
And actually Bathello said that he, when they watch, there is a lot of people in front of the computer. He has a whole army of people.
Yes, he actually just texted me that they are having some challenges sending the picture. We'll get it right, but we are delighted to welcome the large group of Brazilian physicians.
All right, so let me complete it and then we have the picture here in 1 minute. So that is take home message. The DES ISR has histopathologic difference than BMS ISR and respond poorly to interventional treatment. Drug-coated balloon is class 1 indication for DES ISR, although many randomized clinical trials have shown re-DES, especially Everlumus eluting stent, to be superior to DCB in the treatment of DES ISR. Intravascular imaging can identify the mechanism of ISR and could be liberally used to optimize the PCI result. Second, switching antiplatelet therapy with a de-escalation or escalation and from IV to oral should be cautiously done with complete knowledge of the pharmacodynamics of these agents. Current recommendations for the switch seems to incorporate all the existing data and is a good adoption of clinical guideline and routine practice. I told you, it will be our interventional manual update, which I am going to do this week for our upcoming fellow of the July. Quickly, three questions. Following are the randomized clinical trial of drug-coated balloon in the treatment of ISR except ISR Desire 4, DARE, ISR Desire 2, RIPS 4 and RIPS 5. Should be very clear. Second, DS ISR differs from BMS ISR in histopathology in the following aspect except higher proteoglycan content, higher cellular contents, higher neoatherosclerosis, higher inflammation, higher necrotic core. I did talk about it. Hopefully, everybody will answer this question. And the third one is, following are the true statement about antiplatelet therapy switch except use the loading dose of clopidogrel when switching to ticagrelor. Use the loading dose of prasugrel when switching to ticagrelor. Always use the loading dose of prasugrel when switching to clopidogrel. Switching strategy is different in acute and late phase. And switching from IV cangrelor to clopidogrel should be done immediately after terminating the infusion. So this is important. Starting next month will be a 5 questions and it will be a CME event. So we'll make it about 1.5 or 2 hour. We are talking with the CME to make it a CME event with the 5 questions which need to be answered, whatever the minimum they want. I'm just glad that our monthly count of the hits have been about 8,000-10,000 of the CCC Live. And this will just thanks all our supporters.
Sameen, would that be 1 hour of CME or 1.5?
I would say there should be 1.5 or maybe even 2. That's what my goal will be.
Right.
Yeah.
Anu, I see, has stepped out.
No, she's there. She's there with the army. She's right there with the army.
This is the departing fellows, no?
Yeah. The departing army.
Yeah.
Actually, the women fellows, I think they are, I don't know, somehow ACLS and all this is going on. So if you see, like I mentioned earlier, right, how we do our live cases, monthly via webcast, you've seen all the fellows, you know, participating. But more important, you know, the question was when we are doing our symposium, how everything goes so smooth, so good, not only just us pre-planning, is because the backbone of our cath lab is our interventional fellows. So when June comes, you know, they are all independent to do all these complex cases. So we always tell them, we plan how the case has to be done. Otherwise, they already know how this case would have been done in their day-to-day case routine of Mount Sinai Cath Lab. And that is why you see how myself, Dr. Sharma, running from room to room, but we have these fellows already prepared with the cases, and everything went very smooth because of the training that they have received during this fellowship. So what we are going to, we have 8 interventional fellows, and one would be a cath research fellow, 2 structural fellows, and one would be the peripheral fellows. Every year, 1 to 2, we will have women fellows, and they actually, 2 of them, Asma just arrived, but Surbi also, she's not here today on vacation, but that's during the live case, of the all women case, these the group of women who helped doing the live case.
She's also been showing us the apps also.
Yes, yes. So I think this team, especially with the chief fellow is Samit Bateja, he will start talking first. He's the one I think whose interest is technology and innovation. That is how we got into this app
the
business.
Interventional cardiology app man.
Yeah, that's one. And two is that TCT MD actually highlighted two of the fellows, Samit Bateja as well as Surbhi, as they highlight a fellow every month. So they have taken two fellows from Mount Sinai. If you go to tctmd.com, you will see their interviews on featured fellows, they call interventional featured fellows. So I think we will just introduce one by one. This is Samit Bateja, who was the chief fellow for this year. Yes, Samit.
Thank you, Dr. Kini. We actually feel
we don't. The mic needs to be on. One moment.
It is on. It is on. Can you hear?
Go ahead, Samit.
You got it. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Kini. We actually feel very lucky to be part of this interventional cardiology training program because we got to learn all the tips and tricks and all the nitty-gritty details and skills from our mentors, Dr. Kini and Dr. Sharma. As everybody knows, Mount Sinai Cath Lab is one of the highest volume cath lab, busiest cath lab in the country. So that gives us opportunity to see diverse pathology and also very hands-on experience. So we feel very confident when we go out in the wild after graduating to practice. And not only we get training, the environment provided by interventional cardiology program here, environment conducive for nurturing your interests, and they really push you and provide you more and more opportunity and any kind of support possible to get your passion out there for the world to see. So I really want to thank you, Dr. Kini, for that.
Excellent, Samit, and good luck to you where you're proceeding. Follow the guidelines, all the lessons you've learned here, and I'm sure you and the group will do very well.
Thank you.
Now we have Farhan Majid. Actually, we say he is the fellow of all times. Several fellowship he has done. No fellowship that has left. Yes.
So my name is Farhan Majid. I did my interventional in 2009 and then subsequently did my endovascular and my structural fellowships here. What I can say is I want to echo Samit's sentiments in the, the main thing with the fellowship, and I'm the structural fellow this year, is the most important things are volume in a fellowship and hands-on experience. And I think Mount Sinai provides this experience incredibly well. We've gotten to do a number of over 250 TAVRs this year, 50 mitral clips, as well as TMVRs, ASDs, PFOs, so a gamut of procedures. But I really would recommend this program very highly. It's trained me very well for the future. And like I say to any future upcoming fellow, I think you have to look at the program for its volume, which this place has, as well as the hands-on experience. So those are the two main things. So thank you. It's been an honor to be here for the last 2 years to learn endovascular and structural, and I look forward to a continued partnership with Mount Sinai in the future.
Good. And this is Asma.
I'm one of the interventional fellows. I'm one of the two women in the program, as Dr. Kini just mentioned. I will again like to echo Samit's and Farhan's sentiments that this is absolutely an honor and a privilege to be a part of this great program and to have Dr. Sharma and Dr. Kini as our mentors, especially Dr. Kini for me, because she's a woman. She's a trailblazer, as they call women like her. She has done it all, and she continues to be a role model for me and Surbhi. And this program, it's like Farhan said, very hands-on, very high volume, and so many opportunities. And I'll be joining Dr. Krishnan next year as an endovascular fellow, so I'm looking on to that as well.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
We have Mohammed Khan.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mohammed Khan. Just want to thank Dr. Rakini and Dr. Sharma for giving me the opportunity to be trained and such a prestigious program. It's been a great year with my co-fellows, great experience. complexity and volume of cath lab speaks for itself. I don't think so I would be able to get better training anywhere else in the world. This is probably the best program, and I learned a lot during this year. And I'm also fortunate that they selected me to be one of the structural fellows next year, so I'll be staying here, and I'm looking forward to perform well next year as well. Thank you very much.
Good. Then we have Sagar.
Hello, my name is Sagar Reddy. I'm one of the interventional fellows, as you can see. So I don't think I have much to add other than what my co-fellows and my friends told just now. I immensely thank Dr. Keeney and Dr. Sharma for their excellent mentorship. And then I'll continue to excel in whatever ways we can. And then if given a chance, I would definitely choose this fellowship again. That's all I would say. Thank you.
And Sunil. Sunil actually was a cardiology fellow here in Mount Sinai. And from there, he chose to become interventional fellow. So he has been here with us for a few years. Now he's finishing.
So I must say, beyond what is already said, that Dr. Sharma and Dr. Keeney has created an environment of excellence. And I feel very humbled every day to see such complex cases which are referred to them done with such safety and ease. And I hope that Dr. Sharma once remarked that there are times when he feels that when he has a complex patient, it's only God who is on his side. But I feel my training this year is going to be on my side when I will be faced with a complex situation. I also want to add that the staff here is excellent, and I learn a lot from the nursing staff as well as the tech staff here who have years of experience. And the junior attendings here could be program director anywhere they want to go, and they have got such excellent training from Dr. Sharma and Dr. Keeney that I feel my interaction with them, I just learn so much every day. And I feel sad that I will be leaving this program, and I feel like I could stay on, but I think life has to move on.
You have to complete the fellowship at some stage. Okay, here, last fellow now.
My name is Neeraj Shah, and just to add to what everybody said, I would like to thank Dr. Sharma and Dr. Keeney for giving me this opportunity. And like Dr. Keeney mentioned earlier, a stepwise algorithmic approach to complex cases and learning how to plan a case in advance goes a long way in making a complex case simple, and that is what we have learned in this fellowship.
Okay, good. Samir, anything else you want to say?
No, I hearing their perspective is very unique. It you know, every day, one of the, I think it was the last fellow who mentioned the algorithmic approach. I think that is truly the highlight, how these cases are approached. And of course, we wish these all the fellows good luck and welcome the incoming fellows. Anu, there are two questions which have come for you, and also if Sameen is there, I ran through some statistics as to the viewers we had today. But first the questions, what is the antiplatelet strategy in mind, and how would you follow this patient?
Now, this patient has been on the Plavix, and we have done the PRU. PRU is 232, so I think we'll continue on the Plavix itself. That's with regards to
Inodel. The 232, since it's a border, cutoff is 230 or 228 in many trials, and we have put three stents. I think it's a patient has no bleeding issues.
The question, you have to think the Asian population. You say no bleeding issue, but they have very high risk for bleed. Maybe you can give it for
one month. 1 month, yeah, that's fine.
Give it for a month.
Yeah, give 30, and this is the case, you'd give loading dose of 30, that was the trilogy, and every trial showed there, 30 milligram, and based on the weight and age, you give 5 or 10 milligram.
5 milligram.
5 milligram, yeah.
Sameen, here are some data I ran. There were at the peak, there were 10 people on Facebook watching us, 12 on YouTube, and 74 on our website.
Good, beautiful. And usually there are like 10 at each one.
Yeah,
so
that's
600,
what I'm, yeah.
600 people watching, that's a good thing.
This is excellent. Anu, any final comments?
No, I just want to show the staff, because every time we never mention the staff.
That's
we can come
also.
Here. Yeah. Where is Pao? Come here. Who did the case?
The view.
They ran.
Right there. And then Pablo. Yeah, good. All the staff
it
here.
It is a tribute to all these highly skilled nurses and technicians who make these cases possible.
We have a technician.
Panoramic view. Take a picture of the panoramic view.
Panoramic view. Brian.
So, Anu, a quick question. How many years has Pablo been scrubbing with you?
Pablo is dedicated room to.
Come a little further.
Fantastic.
Yeah. And I don't know how many years, Pablo, you've been here?
18.
Unbelievable. Fantastic, yeah. Pablo. Congratulations to the team. Anu, great case.
No, I just want to mention, Pablo, he's our chief tech.
Yes.
And then we have Brian. I would say that he's the in-charge nurse outside, just to make sure. You know, it's not just where you do the case. You during the symposium, you have to also make sure the patients are in the room, outside the room, they are on the right bed. All that movement of the patients, everything has to be managed well. And this is the guy who does everything. And we have the nurses, who is Sarah, who is another nurse always for room two. And here, Leah. She also not only a nurse, she also does in-charge outside. And we have Karina, who is tech also here.
Vicky from the room now. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, Vicky. You have Vicky?
Yeah, Vicky can come here. Can we call Vicky 1 minute? Yeah. We're probably one of the most senior.
And Brian, in addition to the logistics person, is also helping us with the STEMI app.
Yes. Yeah. He's another guy. He has a Bitcoin. What? Bitmine, something like Bitcoin in the basement. So that he can get free money. Free money when he's sleeping.
The most senior person, Vicky. Yeah.
The most senior person who trained Dr. Sharma and Dr. Keeney is Vicky Alamilo here. Okay. Right, Vicky?
All right. With that note, we end our today's fantastic webcast and ready for next month, July 17th.
Yes, that will be our next case. Till then, enjoy our transmission also on C3 and all the cases from the recently concluding meeting will be there in 2 weeks. Thank you so much.